Okay, thank you very much. So we start with the Dhamma talk. Welcome again for everyone today to our Sunday Dhamma talk. The title today is Seeing Through or Understanding Things as They Are. If you go back to the Buddha, he was born as Prince Siddhartha, grown up in luxury. In his earlier days, he never saw any suffering around him. He was pampered from morning to evening. So there were only young, beautiful people around him. He never saw the darker side of existence. Then one day he went out of the palace. He saw the famous four signs, which was an old man, a sick man, and a dead man. Some say a man, could have been a woman as well. And at the end he saw a holy man or a monk. So that gave him an insight into existence. He could see that people are suffering around him. He himself will end up the same way. And seeing the monk, he realized it might be a solution to suffering. Then one day he decided to leave the palace. He left behind his luxury life, his family, and secretly at night he left the palace and he became a wandering ascetic. Then for 6 years he was meditating or practicing this self-mortification, so he was torturing his own body, because at that time in India it was believed this is the way to liberate the mind. So you have to live an ascetic life, you practice the self-mortification, and then one day the karma will come to an end and you may realize enlightenment. But for him, after 6 years, he became very weak and he almost became close to death because he was practicing it in a very serious way. So he realized this is not leading to enlightenment. If I continue that path, I will maybe die, but I will not get enlightened. So then he remembered an occasion from his childhood, actually his first meditation in his childhood, when he was sitting under the rose apple tree. He had once a wonderful meditation. Automatically, he went into deep states of concentration, into jhana. So far, he has rejected that path because he thought it is too pleasant. So he thought enlightenment, the path to enlightenment, should be something harsh, should be something severe. You have to suffer for your enlightenment. But when he remembered this childhood memory, he realized I was very peaceful at that time. I did not feel any negative emotions. So maybe this is the path to enlightenment. So after that, he started practicing samatha meditation. He went into the jhanas. He started with mindfulness practice. And within a short period, he became fully enlightened. Once the Prince Siddhartha was enlightened, from that moment on we call him the Buddha, which means the enlightened one. Also shortly after enlightenment there was an important meeting, because shortly after enlightenment the Buddha thought people will not understand my teaching. He thought the people are very fond of luxury and enjoying their lives. If I teach now the Dhamma, which is based on letting go, on not grasping things, we are not enjoying the sense pleasures, people will not understand it, or they will not like my message. So his first reaction was, let me just sit there under the tree and not teach the Dhamma. Then it is said he got an invitation by Brahma Sahampati, who came there and said, out of compassion, please look again. There are people who can understand this teaching. And the majority of the people will not understand it, but there are many people who have little dust on their eyes. If you teach the Dhamma to them, they will be able to grasp it. They will be able to make some progress. Once he got this formal invitation, the Buddha, with his great compassion, could not reject it. He said, in that case, I am ready to teach the Dhamma. Whoever is ready to accept this teaching, whoever wants to make some progress in meditation, let them hear the Dhamma. Then for the rest of his life, till the age of 85, he was teaching the Dhamma, he was teaching the technique of meditation, and many monks and followers attained enlightenment under his guidance. There are many things have been changed in the Buddhist teaching from the time of the Buddha to now, but there's one formula which we recite when somebody becomes a monk or a nun. And it starts with Sappadukkha Nissarana Nibbana. means for the overcoming of all suffering, for full liberation of my mind, I ordain as a monk or as a nun. So this formula has been the same since the time of the Buddha. We still use it, so that is the main idea. If somebody enters the monk's life or the nun's life, that is the whole idea, to free the mind from all defilements, to develop the mind and reach stages of awakening. So the whole Buddhist teaching is about realization, that is the purpose of the holy life. It is not so much to keep up rituals to attain fame and reputation or to get well supported and have a big monastery. The main idea is realization, waking up one's own mind, and then after that helping others to do the same. So if we meditate and we make some progress in meditation, we go through the vipassana jnanas, or in short, the jnanas. So everybody who makes some progress in meditation, before we attain any of these four stages, sotapanna, sakadagami, anagami, or arahatship, we have to go through the vipassana jnanas, which is a series of insights or understandings about the nature of reality. So these are the eight. In short, they're called Udayappaya jnana, Bhanga jnana, Paya jnana, Adinava jnana, Nipita jnana, Mucita Kamyata jnana, Patisankhanupassana jnana, and Sankhavapeka jnana. Now many meditators who make some progress in this mindfulness meditation may notice these vipassana jnanas one by one very clearly. Other meditators, maybe they note only a few of them, and some may not note them at all. But still, they go through the jnanas, and there's another way to re-arouse these knowledges after attainment. So, in short, Udayappaya jnana, the first one, is called the knowledge of contemplation, of arising and passing away. So the wisdom of contemplating the change of the present phenomena is the knowledge of contemplation, of arising and passing away. So here we can clearly see that the impermanence, things arise and pass away. We get a deep insight into these three characteristics of life, which are anicca, dukkha, and anatta. If somebody attains this knowledge, then impermanence becomes mentally discernible as actually visible. So after this attainment, wherever you look, you just can see the impermanence, you cannot miss it anymore. Wherever you go, whatever you do, you watch your mind, you can see the impermanence, the non-satisfactory nature, and also the non-self nature. So the three characteristics, impermanence, suffering, and non-self, are now very clear. Impermanence is mentally discernible wherever you look and whatever you do. Also, what happens at this jnana is the gana-sanya, that means the perception of me, I, or mine, the compactness, the belief that there is a unity which you call I, me, or mine, or the ego, is breaking up at this stage. So the tendency to take as a unit what is really just a coming together of many small factors is breaking up. So the I, me belief is breaking up. You understand ultimately there is no self, the self is an illusion. So the rising and passing movements of the, let's say you use the breath for your meditation, becomes less and less palpable. This is the point at which the concept is breaking up. So the concept of I, me, or mine. The second jnana is called the Bhanga jnana, the knowledge of contemplation of dissolution. When a meditator no longer sees the rising of formations, but only their dissolution, he has arrived at this knowledge. Now, again, in the case of using the breath as your main meditation object, what usually happens, you start feeling the out-breath only. So you don't feel the in-breath, you feel only the out-breath. Or bodily, many feel it as sensations, the whole body is vibrating at a higher rate, and body is breaking up, body's compactness is breaking up. You no longer have this idea that there's a compact I, me, or mine. The next jhana is called the bhayajnana, knowledge of appearance as terror. So when everything is disintegrating, the meditator feels as though he is in a helpless condition. Since the mind-body process to which he has been clinging his whole life is suddenly breaking up, it can lead to alarm or terror. Now, the many of these jnanas, if you explain these jnanas, some of them may sound negative, but still it is a very important understanding which we need later for attainment. Also, it can happen. Now, usually a meditator passes through these jnanas very quickly, often in one or two sittings, but it can happen that meditators get stuck in one or the other jnanas. And let's say you would be stuck in this one, the bhayajnana, it would be a very unpleasant experience. The important thing for a meditator is to note these stages very well. So once you feel you are in one of these stages, try to be aware, I feel now this bhayajnana or the appearance as terror, then usually you pass on very quickly to the next level. The next one is adinavanyana, the knowledge of contemplation of danger. The understanding dawns that the entire samsaric existence, past, future and present, is subject to the same dissolution. With this insight, the knowledge of terror gives rise to an awareness of the danger of formations. And this is called adinavanyana. So here the terror is subsiding and we just see the danger. So with more clarity we can see this reality or this existence is very dangerous. There is no I, me or mine. At any moment this existence can break up. So I have to find a solution to liberate my mind from this reality. So the meditator sees no advantage whatsoever in the entire mass of formations. He gets disgusted with all formations. So usually here at this stage you no longer grasp anything strongly. You're disillusioned with your reality and you try to find very strongly a liberation from this samsaric journey. Next one is, the fifth one is called Nipitanyana, the knowledge of contemplation of disenchantment. When the dangerous informations are understood, the disenchantment sets in without any special effort. This knowledge of disenchantment arises through dissatisfaction with formations. So it's a kind of knowledge with which a meditator has to be very well acquainted. Now they say this fifth one, the Nipitanyana, is one of the most important ones. So the contemplation of disenchantment, so to reflect on the grasping or the holding on to things, does not lead to any joy or happiness. By letting go, we free the mind from all defilements. The meditator gets very whimsical often at this stage, so the dissatisfaction is aroused by perception of danger of formations. So here at this stage, the meditator becomes very whimsically, he changes his meditation, he tries to change the seat, often he tries to change the place he is going for meditation. Also he tries to change maybe, or he gets unhappy with the teacher or with the instructions. So he tries to change many things, he is not happy with his practice, but still he keeps going in the meditation. Another sign of this stage is that he does not let go of meditation, also he tries to find other things, but still he sticks to his meditation. The sixth one is called Munjita Kamidanyana, the knowledge of desire for deliverance. The knowledge of disenchantment is followed by this knowledge. The meditator now becomes very eager to liberate the mind from all defilements. So he gets very serious about meditation. Usually at this stage, the meditator tries to meditate day and night, so he tries to spend every free moment to spend in meditation and to find liberation from all samsara. The seventh one is called Patisankhanupassananyana, the knowledge of contemplation of reflection. Now here at this jnana, we start seriously thinking, what is the problem? Why I'm stuck here in this existence? What is the solution to this suffering or this state of mind? And we realize by letting go, by not grasping anything, I can find liberation. Also this Panchupadana Skanda, which we discussed earlier already, becomes very clear at this stage. So if you sit in meditation and impressions from the six senses are coming in, you realize if I just observe things without grasping, without pushing away, I do not create any new karma, and I can free my mind from all suffering or all attachments. So at this stage, usually physical pain may arouse. Many meditators at this stage, they find they have headache or back pain, and some go for massages. Many feel various discomforts in the body and mind, but still they are continuing with their meditation. The last one of the jnanas is called Sankhara Bhekka Jnana, the knowledge of equanimity about formations. Now this one from all the jnanas is a very pleasant one. It feels very peaceful. The mind is no longer shaken by the ups and downs. So at this stage, the equanimity or the peacefulness arises from the knowledge that all the foundational work has been already done. So we have understood that there is no I, me, or mine. We have a deep understanding of the impermanence, of the suffering nature, of the non-self nature, and we also realized by letting go of all the impressions, we can free the mind from all defilements. So the mind becomes keener and keener until it reaches a stage of unruffled peace. So at this stage, the meditation becomes very automatic. You need not to make any effort anymore. As soon as you sit down in meditation, it goes automatically, effortlessly. Meditation becomes like your second reality. You start living in these meditative experiences. Even during the day, mindfulness is automatically there. So you remain mindful, peaceful, and in harmony with yourself. So much so that some people even misunderstand this last jnana for the attainment of enlightenment already, because the mind feels very calm and peaceful. But at this stage, the defilements are still there. Only we suppress them, or we don't feel them anymore. Also, some meditators who are unable to go any further from this point onwards, these are the people who have the vow of a bodhisattva or of somebody who wants to become a main disciple of a future Buddha. So if you have any of these vows or intentions, you cannot go any further in your meditation. But even for these people, the vipassana jnanas, these knowledges are very important. They give the insight necessary to purify this vow of a Buddhahood or of a main disciple. Awakening is said to be twofold. There is the spiritual awakening and the worldly awakening. Now, if we awake spiritually, some say as a side effect, you also start seeing what is going on around you. You see what is happening in our society, what is happening around us. Our eyes are open to these things, even in a worldly sense. If you look at this picture, what can you see? Is it a rock with some snow on it, or can you see horses? Yeah, you can see horses. They say these pictures are often used to check the mind. The obvious picture is some rocks with some snow on it, but there is a hidden picture inside. Usually at first sight we see the rock and the snow. Looking carefully, or especially if somebody points it out, you can see, oh no, there's a bunch of horses there. So that is the secondary picture which is hidden within the other picture. So often in society, things are happening around us, we are deceived by information. The obvious picture is not always the real picture. So with insight, with understanding and knowledge, often our eyes are open. And they said once the eyes are open, they can never be closed again. And this worldly awakening, understanding what is going on around you, what is happening in society, many say it can be a very painful process, but a necessary one. I think if somebody is spiritually awake, Also he has to understand what is going on in a worldly sense. Also about these pictures again shortly, they say this kind of pictures, after somebody pointed out there is a hidden picture inside, next time you see this kind of pictures, the first thing you will see is the horses, is the hidden picture and not the obvious one. So once the eyes are open, they can never be closed again. There's a movie, an old movie, called They Live from 1988. The story is that there are some hidden things around in society, hidden messages, hidden like aliens, it's about aliens. But as soon as you put on the sunglasses, you can see the other reality. When you take the glasses off again, you are deluded, you see only the obvious around you. Often that is also used as a simile about meditation and awakening. So as soon as you awake, your eyes are open, it's like putting on the glasses and you can see deep inside, you can see what is actually going on around you. So the time for playing make-believe is long over. Humanity is waking up. Humanity does no longer want to just believe blindly anything. People want to know, they want to understand, and they want to realize. So nowadays people are not satisfied just with following or accepting things. They want to understand things. They want to meditate, they want to find out, they want to realize how the mind is working. And if enlightenment or any higher stages of consciousness are possible, then they want to experience that. So that is the new outlook, and that's why especially in Western society, about 25 to 30% of the people say that we are spiritual but not religious. In Buddhism we have a word called satta, which is often wrongly translated as faith. It means confidence, confidence in the practice. So if you practice a certain type of meditation or any spiritual practice, once you see it's working for you, it's helping me, my good qualities are increasing, my bad qualities are getting less and less, then you develop confidence in your practice. So satta implies experiential confidence based on your experience and not on blind belief. We have the education system, which is nowadays not really educating, it's serving another purpose. So we can also, if you look at the statistics, now the most money is spent, for example, in the USA for the education. But if you check, compared with other countries, it's the worst outcome. And they say you get what you pay for, so it's all designed for a certain purpose. Like the so-called founder of the American education system, John D. Rockefeller, said, "I don't want a nation of thinkers, I want a nation of workers." And so the education system is designed to create obedient workers, but not the great thinkers. And also, D. Rockefeller said this, "We are on the verge of a global transformation. All we need is the right major crisis, and the nations will accept a new world order." And also what they mean with new world order is a new form of the old. More control, more super rich, and more super poor. People. Also entertainment, I always said this, there's nothing wrong with having fun. If you are very fond of entertaining yourself all the time, like nowadays many are addicted to the phones and the computers and stuff, what it does actually, it brings you away from reality. So more and more you go into another dream state and it will be even more difficult for you to wake up from this one. So many believe even this reality is already a dreamlike state. Entertainment, especially these new 3D super interesting computer games, they take you into another deeper dreamlike state. And then through meditation or any spiritual practice, it will be even more difficult to wake up from reality. So entertainment, there's an old saying, it says bread and circus. So as soon, as long as you give the people enough to eat and give them entertainment, they will not revolt. So as soon as you take away either the bread or the circus, then the ruling people have a problem. So nowadays the entertainment is in the form of all these phones and computers and tablets. So it is very amazing new technology. We should use it. I use it right now. But we should be very careful. We should limit the time and not to lose our reality in this present moment. The other one is the mainstream media. Now it's a proven fact that worldwide the mainstream media is controlled by about five families. And so they decide what the world is thinking. So it's not really news, it's what they want you to believe is real. There are mainstream, besides mainstream media, there are now alternative news channels, which are still bringing real news, especially if you watch the research on the internet. You can find the real stories, the backgrounds, the real information. Somebody asked me once, why do you think the internet is so much better than the mainstream media? And the simple explanation is this: the mainstream media is controlled by five families. The internet, millions of people are putting on information on the internet. So the internet cannot be controlled completely. It is a variety of information. Of course, you have to sort it out, you have to research, you have to find the information, but all the information is there. Also, when it comes to the internet, you think it's the best invention humanity has ever got. So earlier, if you wanted to have some information, you had to go to a library to find some books. That the books were very limited. But nowadays, within a few minutes, you can get all the information you need. But you have to know where to look for it. The other thing is the political class. We have fake politicians who do not really serve. I don't mean any personal. they are not serving the people, they are serving somebody else. So there's a global cabal who is ruling, but they are not for the people. Like the best example for me is the German Chancellor, not to mention her name, but she is definitely working against the German people and not for the German people. Nowadays we can see the French Revolution going on. Macron, he's another one. The main critic the people have is that he is working not for the French people, he is working for the globalists. So there are politicians who are not having the best interests of the people in mind, and that way Australia, I think, is still exemplary, as a much better than the rest of the other countries. Then coming back to the New World Order, so what many say, yeah, that is good, it's a new way of living together, this global village idea. So what is wrong with it? Why not going for it? We all live together peacefully, we don't need borders, we are all brothers and sisters. If you look at the people who are trying to put this New World Order in place, these are very evil, corrupt, selfish, ruthless people. So what kind of New World Order do you think they want to create? So it is not a New World Order of free liberal people, it will be something completely different. So the whole idea of living together in harmony, all are same, of course humanity is ready and they like that. So they use these terms, but they have some different idea behind it. So the New World Order they are talking about will be more like a global enslavement and not for the liberty of the human people. So the ruling class, and again some people say it's about 12 families who run the show, they are centered in Europe and America, and there's a lot of research done about that. Also they say there are about 80 corporations who own about 80% of the world's resources, so they are owning basically everything, and they are running the show. Only there is a lot of resistance, humanity is waking up, and they can see this is not going in the right direction, and so there a future big conflict is about to happen. Or as George Carlin says, governments don't want well-informed, well-educated people, capable of critical thinking. That is against their interests. They want obedient workers, people who are just smart enough to run the machines and do the paperwork, and just dumb enough to passively accept it. And he was an American comedian, and he passed away a few years ago. He had the talent to bring things in a funny way, but very deep information. And he was once invited at the White House to give a they invited him as a comedian, and he was fooling the politicians there. He was telling all the wrong things they do right into their face, but because he was bringing it in a funny way, they were all laughing with him. They were not angry with him, they were enjoying it, but actually he told them to the face everything they do wrong. So if you're more interested in this kind of topics, you Google Bilderberg and you will be, it will be a real eye-opener. You just Google Bilderberg and see what comes up. Or you read any of these books, 1984 or The Brave New World by George Orwell or Aldous Huxley. These were all insiders who were part of this global elite and later jumped off and were spreading awareness against it. So we have the choice either to have a freedom or fascism worldwide. The choice is always with the people. The people have the power. We are creating our future. And the whole basis of controlling people is always on the basis of keeping them in a state of not knowing. So if you delude the people, if you brainwash them into believing certain things, only then the world, our society, can be pushed in the wrong direction. So knowledge and liberation go hand in hand. As soon as you know what's going on around you, if you inform yourself, if you put some time into your research, and also, of course, use the meditation to liberate your mind from all the grasping, you will be able, or nobody will be able to control you, and we can turn our global society into a free, just, and liberal society. Like Wolfgang von Goethe said, none are more hopelessly enslaved than those who falsely believe they are free. And many people think, what's the problem? I'm fine, everything is okay. What is this with these conspiracy theories? But those people who think they are free without knowing what's going on, they are the easiest to be controlled. So together we can change the world. First we have to know what's going on. We try to be well informed. Use all the information. Information is power. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. So it was always just a small group of well-informed people, awakened people, who made a change in our human history. They said also, like America, when they were fighting for liberation, it was a minority. They said it was about 5% of the population who were awake, aware of what's going on. They were fighting for liberation. They broke off from the British Empire, and they attained liberation. And also many things, the United States, when they started off, it was started with great spiritual ideas of respecting the human being, of liberty and just society. Only over time, they lost this ability again, they got infiltrated. And nowadays, I think the US is not a great example anymore. But they started off with very good ideas, and that was the original idea. You need a small group of devoted people, awake people, and they can change, they can make a big change in society. But the majority of the people are living in a hypnotic trance state of mind, so we have to wake up to reality and start asking the big questions. Who are we? Where are we? What is reality? And very few people ever ask these big questions. Very few people ever start with any kind of spiritual practice, and also the majority of the people just accept what is done to them. Those who know the least obey the best. And so that's a very true saying. So the people who are not well informed, who just accept everything they are told, they're the easiest to be controlled, and that's the people they want, and they train through the education system. Like Deepak Chopra always talks about the critical mass, and he says it seems about 100 million, he says, would be enough to change global society into a utopian society or a better society. Many are doubting the number. He says about a few percent would be enough. But let's say we need 20% of the world population to be dharmic people, meditative, spiritual people who are awake, who know what's going on, then definitely we could change society for the better. So this is therefore meditation. First, we have to start with the personal practice, of course. We have to work on our own mind to liberate the mind on a spiritual level. As a side effect, you awaken also in a worldly sense. Additionally, you start then, usually at this point, researching things. Whatever you hear in the news, whatever others tell you, you just immediately know, ah, this is true, this is not true. I know why they are saying this and that. So you are awake, and the eyes, once opened, cannot be closed anymore. So the technique of meditation is very important for your personal liberation. We can attain higher levels of consciousness, which is known by many different traditions under many different names, like God realization, Nibbana, enlightenment, moksha, or liberation. So the goal of this meditation technique is to purify the mind, to free it from misery by gradually eradicating the negativities within you. It is an Goenka called it the deep operation into your subconscious mind. And also that's why Goenka, they do the 10-day meditation retreats. And he says never, when you come for a retreat, you are not allowed to go home after 3 or 4 days. Once you start, you have to stay the whole 10 days. And he compared it like somebody lying on the operation table and you open the belly up and suddenly the guy jumps up and runs home. So he says it would be very unhealthy. Similar, if you start with this deep meditation, you are in a retreat in this 10-day setting, you have to finish it. So don't run away in the middle. You have to finish the whole program. At the end, they do like metta meditation, that is like cleaning up the wound again, and then you are ready to leave the place to go home again. So you yourself are your own refuge. Nobody else can do the job for you. You have to work on yourself. You have to use your own meditation. So you have to explore reality within yourself. You have to liberate your own mind. There's a saying from the Buddha, it's called Atta Yata No Nato, meaning only you yourself can free your own mind. So even if a holy person or the Buddha would be standing right in front of us, even he could only show the direction where we have to go. They are not, but he cannot do the meditation for you. He cannot liberate your mind. That is called an inside job, so you have to do it for yourself. So the Buddha nature is within you. Also, it is not like the enlightened state, we have to go somewhere and find it out there. The Buddha nature is within each and every one of you. Only usually it is covered up by defilements, by negative karmas. So we have to clean up the subconscious mind and let this Buddha nature shine again. So what we talked last time about the higher levels of consciousness, so this you are pure consciousness having a human experience. Once you clean up your consciousness from all the negative emotions, negative karmas, this Buddha nature, this higher level of consciousness is starting to shine. Also the Buddha called himself a Kalyanamitra and not a guru. There's the guru idea, which means if you have a teacher, whatever the teacher or the guru says, you have to follow. If the teacher says jump off the cliff, you have to jump. That is the obedience towards the teacher. In Buddhism, we don't have this idea. We have the Kalyanamitra idea, which means a noble friend. So even if the Buddha or some very holy person is your teacher, you have the right to question everything the teacher does. So whenever you see maybe the teacher is 80% perfect, but everybody has some shortcomings, when you see something wrong in the teacher, you have the right to point that out. In a polite way, you can say, sorry teacher, I think now you're going wrong. And if it's a good teacher, he will really think about it, and if it's true, he will accept it. There's one famous story about Venerable Sariputta, who was the main disciple of the Buddha. And he was known, he was for one thing, the foremost disciple in knowledge, and he was also known to be very humble. So he had one disciple, a young boy, who was one day walking behind him when they walked to the village for alms round, and it seems the robe of the Venerasari Buddha was hanging down and was on the road. The young disciple pointed it out. He said, "Sorry, sir, but your robe is not properly. You're not properly dressed. That's not right to do." When Venerasari Buddha stopped, he looked down and he thought, "Ah, he's right." So he rearranged his robe, and then he worshipped the boy and he said, "Thank you. You are right. I accept it." So if it's a real good teacher, that's what he usually should do. So if something is pointed out, that doesn't mean he has to accept everything, but he has to check it. You see, if that is true, then if he's humble enough, he should accept it. So that is the idea of Kalyana Mitra versus the guru idea. Also, the saying that often you hear this even in Buddhism, they say, no, it is in our holy books, that's why it must be right. And it said so, that means the Buddha has done so, that's why we do it even nowadays the same way, so don't question it, it is proven by the Tripitaka. Now Buddhism is not that kind of belief or that kind of religion. So even if it says so in the books, which by the way have been written down about 500 years after the Buddha, and if you have ever done this, I don't know how you call this in English, the silent boast. You sit around, you whisper something into the ear of the next one, and it goes around one to the other. And till the message comes back to you, usually it's very, very twisted. So if you write down something after 500 years, you can be sure at least a little bit it will have changed. And during that time also, the possibility is always there that things have been introduced later, things have been taken out, or simply changed a little bit. So only because it is in an old dusty book, it does not mean that that is what the Buddha actually did or that is the original message. So the only authority we have in Buddhism or any spiritual practice is your own experience. So when you see something with your five senses, so you really experience it, then you can take it as real. Anything else can only be a guideline, so I believe the Tripitaka is the most original books about Buddhism we have, but even those books I would not take for 100%. So we have to, any text, any information, any teaching from a teacher, even if it's a very holy monk or a holy teacher, we should take it very carefully. So we should never switch off our critical thinking and we should try to experience it for ourselves. So discover the power of critical thinking, that is one big characteristic of a Buddhist or a meditative person, even a spiritual person. So he takes nothing for granted, he uses his critical thinking from moment to moment. So how can you develop your critical thinking skills? First, ask basic questions. And often I hear this when somebody explains something, they say, explain this to me as if I would be a six-year-old. So tell it in a simple way, I want to hear it simple. Question basic assumptions. Keep an open mind. Try reversing things. Understand your own biases. Read great books, but with an open mind. Put yourself in other people's shoes. Playing with people smarter than you. And the last one also was one major advice of the Buddha, noble friendship. So he says, stick together with people who are good friends, noble friends, who are more spiritual or more into the Dhamma than you, then sooner or later you can learn something from your friends. Also, what is called the Dharmic religions, they are not based on any book. And with Dharmic religion, I mean these three. It's Buddhism, Hinduism, and Jainism. And all these three religions are based on experience. So they have books, of course, they have holy books, like the Gita, the Hindu books, and the Buddhist books. But the main authority in all these three religions is your own experience, as opposed to the Abrahamic religions. So an enlightened society, the Buddha with his Dharma strove to bring about an enlightened society founded on justice, freedom, community, talents, and universal well-being of the people. And to maximize all this, he recommended a spiritual practice like meditation. Also, he established these basic morals, the five precepts. So his whole intention was, for one thing, personal liberation, but also to establish a more enlightened society around us. He also called the Sangha the brotherhood of the Dhamma. So what we would need also worldwide is such a brotherhood of dharmic or spiritual people, a dharmic society for the benefit of all mankind. Humanity, if you look back in history, we have suffered enough. So it would be time to make a change and to start something better, something new. The philosophy of the innocent, some also call the Buddhists the innocent people. Some also think that then it turns to they start trying to misuse that. But innocent just means pure at heart. I heard this story in England once, a very devoted Buddhist lady. She was working in an office, and she was the innocent one, the compassionate one. Whenever they told her, please do this, help me, I have to go earlier, take it over, she always said yes. And then one day she realized they are misusing me, they're using my kindness, so I can't keep that up anymore. So one day, when she was asked in the office again, please do this, I have to go earlier, she said no. And as soon as she said no, all looked at her direction, said, what? And then even one said it with these words. They said, but I thought you are a Buddhist. And then she said, yes, I'm a Buddhist, but I'm not foolish. And so it does not mean that if you are innocent, kind Buddhist, that others can make advantage of you. There's nothing wrong in sometimes saying firmly, that is how much I go, I cannot do this. So that is called wisdom. So if you say something sternly, that also is part of the Buddhist teaching. It does not mean that you have to say it with anger. And there are many examples that we can speak forcefully without the anger. And that's the big challenge. So sometimes to say something very firmly, but without the anger involved. But Buddhists are known as being the innocent people. Buddhism has never been used for any spiritual war. So Buddhists are usually doing their own thing, they're compassionate, and they're known for being very tolerant. And I always say, if there are many books in many different traditions, I say, this is the Bible, this is the most holy book. I think if any book could be called the Bible, a worldwide universal Bible, it would be the Dhammapada. The Dhammapada is a summary of all the Buddhist texts. And if you read the Dhammapada, there's no point where you can say, this is definitely wrong, or this is cruel, or this would lead to the suffering of anybody. So if you read the Bible, the Dhammapada Bible, yeah, it's a very innocent book, and there's nothing, you cannot find anything wrong in that book. And there's one monk, he's actually now living in Australia. His name is Dhammasiya, a German monk. He's now the chief monk of one temple in Brisbane. But he used to come to Mitrigal at our meditation center, and actually he was traveling all over India just in search of wisdom when he was very young. And in India, somebody offered him the Dhammapada, and he was just reading the book. And he said he did not understand everything that was in the book, but he said, I could not find any spot where I could say, this is definitely wrong. So it attracted him. He said, what is this? I want to find out more about this Buddhist teaching. So then he came to Sri Lanka, later he ordained as a monk. He later came to Ajahn Brahm's place, and now he is the chief monk of a small meditation center near Brisbane. So the Dhammapada, I call it, that would be like a Bible for our future society. This is a saying from David Icke. He's an English researcher, and for those who know him, I'm not propagating everything he says, but he has some very good points, and he says this here. I don't care who you are, what you are, what you have achieved in your life, which title you have got, how much money and how much wealth you have. I don't believe in any religion, new age, science, teachers and doctors, politicians, monarchs and media. I have no faith in the system of religion, system of government. But if you are a pure, genuine human being, I respect you and you are my teacher. So this is a very wonderful saying from him, and he has very good ideas. Also, he talks a lot about aliens, and so forget about it. That part is very critical, but he has the spiritual side, and he has a very good side of it. So I just believe in my experience. I'm consciousness and me. That's my reality. Remember who you are, where you are, and what your purpose is here on this planet. So we are all here for a certain purpose, for mainly for our own awakening, getting experiences, but also to change something outside. So we can influence society by our practice, by our even our vibrations we create. So peaceful, tolerant vibrations will itself create a change around you. But especially if you are deep into meditation, you can share your experiences with the others. And if you know about the Dharma, the Buddhist teaching, you can discuss and share that as well. So little by little, we create a change around us. And many people say, if you look worldwide, there is a great awakening happening right now. So there is a mass awakening, and I hope 2019 we will win. So the innocent Buddhists and spiritual people, they will make a big change in this new year. So there is a mass awakening going on. People are getting much more interested in meditation, mindfulness, often also not under the Buddhist umbrella, but under mindfulness meditation. It is growing very fast, and people are waking up in huge, big mass awakening is happening right now. So enlightenment, there is no freedom without wisdom. Wisdom, knowledge, and liberty go hand in hand. So look through the illusion, free your mind from all defilements. So may you all be able to continue on the Dhamma path. May you all find peace and happiness. Make quick progress in your meditation. May you all experience the Vipassana jnanas, all these knowledges, and may you all be able to liberate your mind and reach stages of awakening. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. At the end, a short chanting to bless you all. Sabitiyo vivacantu sabbarogo vinasatu mati pavattantarayo sukidigayo kobhava bhavattu sappamangalam rakandu sappadivata Sapa Buddha Nubhavena Sada Sati Bhavantuti Apivadana Silesa Nichang Vata Pachayino Chattaro Dhamma Vadanti Ayuvarna Sukhang Balanti. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Also, because some people were asking last time, on my website you can get some guided meditations and also some short Dhamma talks. Whoever is interested, visit that website. Also, there's a link to the YouTube channel, and there are more guided meditations there. So with that, we come to the end. We have still time for questions and answers. So if you want to ask anything about the Dhamma Talk, about your spiritual practice, please ask now. Now is the time.
Bhante, short question. Yep. I mean, the concept of believing your own experience is a good concept, but wouldn't that be also a dangerous concept in the sense that always people believe in their own self? So basically, their own experience is based on their own self, which is full of delusion, so that's where all the arguments comes from. that's all the war, yeah. World war started based on that concept.
The idea, the ego is a wrong idea. That's an illusion. Yeah. What I mean with believing your own experience is, let's say you do a certain type of meditation. Let's say you practice Vipassana meditation, and over a period of time, after 1 or 2 or 3 months, you can see that there's less anger in you. You can see I'm not less greedy. I'm more friendly with people. I'm less. My mind is much clearer. So you can see negative things go down and positive things come up. So you get a faith in your experience or confidence in your experience. So you trust that this meditation is leading in the right direction. It means not just your whimsical
philosophical ideas, since I believe in something and that is true because I believe it, it should be based on your experience. So when you, whatever you practice and you see the bad things go down, good things are coming up, I feel more compassionate now, I find it easier to manage with people, I'm much more relaxed. Whenever I sit down, I meditation, I feel just peaceful. So all this shows your practice is going the right direction. So that's what I mean with you trust your experience. On the other hand, if you practice anything, you are part of a group and they do certain kinds of rituals and you feel like I'm getting more and more angry and I'm getting more and more restless, so that after a period you realize this cannot be the right way. So they must practice something which is against the Dhamma. So it's leading me away from reality or from experience. So you stop it, you change the practice and you start something new. So that's what I meant with trusting your experience. Okay, is that answered with that?
Thank you, Bhante. I guess what we're really kind of talking about here is the development of the wisdom factor from watching, as you say, the development of the good qualities in our mind, and perhaps also the realization that our opinion is one of very many trillions, and the less significant we become, the less important that opinion becomes. So it is a wisdom factor, it is wisdom.
We develop wisdom. Now, this idea of I, me, or mine is not based on wisdom. That is, it turns out to be illusion. So the more progress you make in meditation, the ego breaks away. So then the more you realize this idea, this ego is an illusion, but what comes up is this, what I call universal consciousness or the pure Buddha nature. Then you're just, you are in the present moment, you're just peaceful with yourself, you're very compassionate, you don't feel anger towards others. So all these qualities are getting stronger. So wisdom leads to liberation. And part of this understanding of wisdom, like I mentioned in the jnanas, is also that this I belief breaks up. So also that the I belief, the ego, is breaking up. So also that is one of the signs of a progress, that the ego is breaking up. So you no longer have this strong me, I, mine. And also they say there's, in opposition to the Buddhist or the Dharma, there's another philosophy out there, I don't even want to say the name of it, but many high up people are following a certain philosophy which is totally directly opposed to the Buddhist teaching or the Dhamma. And one of their main ideas is, whatever brings you forward is good. So whenever you can, you know, struggle to be the first, that justifies everything else. So you can do anything bad, killing, stealing, raping, as long as you end up on top, it is fine. So that is the direct opposite to the Buddhist teaching. So in Buddhism we say, because we take care of others, we are tolerant and we are compassionate, because of these good qualities we move forward. So maybe not so much in the corrupt worldly sense, but in the spiritual sense we move forward. And also many people say that ultimately all people are connected. So on the spiritual level we are all connected, some even say we are all one. So the whole awakening can only go hand in hand with all the people around you. It is a personal practice, you also lead all the others along with it. So let's say in this whole hall there's one person who meditates and wakes up, then also automatically will influence all the people around them, and also they will find it much easier also to follow the path to enlightenment. So ultimately we work on ourselves, but also we take care of society. And there are many people also who say, why are you talking about worldly things? The Buddha never did that. He was only concerned with the spiritual awakening. Not true. So there were many stories in the Buddhist texts where the Buddha was fighting with the Brahmins. There are many stories where the Buddha was arguing with the Brahmins about the caste system. He was totally against it. And that means that that was a worldly concern, because he wanted to change also society. Not so much as doing the spiritual practice, but he was also concerned with society around him. So he was not blind to what went on in India at that time. Yeah, but yeah, very good question. Anything else? Any other question?
Thank you, Bhante. I think for young people now, it's much easier to find pleasure from computer games instead of sitting on the mat and doing meditations. And there was a talking about the artificial intelligence will take over. And what is your idea, your perception on that?
AI, we had that, I think, 1 or 2 weeks ago, about the danger of this whole AI, the artificial intelligence. And I heard from one monk who is in Newbury now, he talked about that, and he said, I don't think there's a danger, because if AI becomes really intelligent, then it should be also know what is compassion. So once it is intelligent, maybe it learns also what compassion is. But I don't think it's true, because AI is designed especially for that, to be very logical without compassion. And for those people, they also say the leaders of the world, they have one character trait, and that is that they don't have any compassion. So that is just missing. They don't have that part of it. And so if you don't have compassion, you're basically able to do anything. So they see it as an advantage. So then you are unlimited to do anything. But compassion is the big thing, what humanity, that's our biggest quality. So we know what others feel around us, and AI doesn't have that. So if there are there are many predictions, if AI really takes over, that would be the end of humanity as we know it, then any kind of spiritual practice, meditation, liberation, all this would be impossible. So once the human mind is connected to AI computer, you are no longer, the free will is going away, and you would have no choice anymore even to do any spiritual practice. And there are many insiders who paint a very dark picture. They say, like this Elon Musk in America, he says this is the last, Julian Assange, who is actually an Australian, he says he believes this is the last generation where we have a free will, and after that it will be over. That's what he says. And he talks about nanotechnology and AI and all these things. And Elon Musk is the other one in America. He says that AI is already so far advanced it cannot be stopped anymore. And he says by the time we realize there is a danger, it will be much too late to do anything. So if that all is true, there's this danger is there. So far we have still the free will, we know what is meditation, we can still make progress, but we don't know how long. So we don't, maybe there's not so much time left anymore. Also we have to say that the agenda is, now the agenda is more AI and the humans are becoming more and more like slave-like beings, but that is just one, somebody wants to have that. That does not mean it actually will happen. Humanity, if the humanity wakes up fast enough, we can all stop all that. We can change it differently, we can have another outcome, and we can create a reality which is wonderful for the human beings, with much more liberation, much more spiritual, that everybody already learns meditation, yoga in the school. So we can have a utopian society. It's up to the human beings. They say if they wake up fast enough, we can change all that for the better. If human beings continue to sleep, then that may be an option, that is a possible future, but hopefully not. So hopefully it will not happen. Yeah. But the danger is there. Yeah. It is dangerous. Yeah. Okay, yeah, very good question. Also, there was one about the free will, that they say that human beings have a free will. And like there was a discussion between the Buddha and the other yogis. So the Buddha was for there is a free will. Also, most is conditioned by past lives, by past karma, but we have a choice. So in every moment we can decide either the good or the bad, or we have all this kind of information, so we can make a change. The change is with the human society. The humans have the power to create anything. So we are pushed in one direction. That doesn't mean that that has to happen. We can make a change. Okay. Any other? Do we have anything online?
Okay. Oh, we have two questions online. The first one is, when one gets disgusted by all formations, is there a danger of falling into aversions? Or in this case, is aversion wholesome?
Yeah, so this one of the jnanas, so it can be very unpleasant at that moment, or the aversion, you don't find any joy in anything, you are very disgusted with everything, you see the danger in reality. They told me to look at the camera, not over there. And so there is this danger, but usually you go through the jnanas and you go very fast. So this is one, often it happens in one sitting or in one or two sittings of meditation, you go through all the jnanas. So you get one of these insights, it lasts maybe a few minutes, and you move on to the next one. In rare cases, you can get stuck in one of these jnanas, and that would be like a person, you can see him from far. So if you meet a person, it's like all disgusting and everything negative, and he may be stuck in one of the jnanas. So it can happen rarely, and then the solution is you have to note it. So in your meditation, when you feel this same insight is happening again and again, just note it. This feeling is not there, this sensation is there, and then usually move on to the next one. So it would be potentially unpleasant to be stuck in one of the jnanas, but usually you pass through very quickly. And also some of the jnanas, the experience may be unpleasant, but you need that knowledge for going further. So you need that understanding, everything is impermanent, nothing makes sense. But then it leads to the last one, the Sankhara Pekkanjana, which you gather all this knowledge, and it is the basis for attaining the first stage of awakening. So at the last, the Sankhara Pekkanjana, everything is very calm, very peaceful. Also they say the main difference between the last jnana and the first stage of awakening is that in the last jnana, everything around you, you experience everything still there, but it does not come into your mind and it does not trouble you. In the first stage of awakening, all this greed, hate and delusion is completely, you start destroying it at the root. So that's why some people are mistaking the last jnana for the first enlightenment. But yeah, to the question again, so it could be unpleasant, but it's not dangerous because it's not, you usually don't stay there long. You get that insight and then you move on to the next one. Yeah. Okay, so what's the other one?
Second question. I like to be active in social justice, for example, standing up for human rights, but I don't want to be dragged into violence or contention. Do you have any suggestion for this?
Yeah, violence is never good. So you can also see from all this movements, like revolutions and things, the most successful one was Gandhi's. And that was the peaceful revolution. Whenever there comes violence in, also many say violence is actually what they want. So if there's a system in place which tries to suppress human rights and so on, you fight them violently, they're waiting for that because they are ready, they have the guns and they are, you can't fight them with violence. You cannot conquer this with violence. The only solution is a peaceful revolution. Like my best example is always Gandhi. So just passive resistance. You're no longer supporting a system which is wrong. You're not doing anything that helps them, but you are peaceful. You're peaceful, you don't fight, you're not violent, you don't do any crimes. That is the best example, and it happened so many times. Like there was, I think, once a demonstration in Thailand, and recently it happened also in Paris, that the police, because they could see the majority of these people were peaceful. They were the French people peacefully demonstrating against something they were not happy about. And the police, many of them took off the helmet and put it down and showed, we are with you, we are with the people. So if you start fighting the police, of course, they have to protect themselves, they fight back. So the best revolution or the spiritual revolution is the peaceful one. So not with violence, that gives the wrong signal. So it should be all based on non-violence and just showing we don't support the wrong system anymore. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Over there we have a question. Ranjit wants to ask a question.
Pandey, there is a question which is more often we have experienced, not that we have experienced, we have heard that nowadays Buddhism is getting confused. Mm. Right. Maybe by so many people writing books of different nationalities and interpreting the sutras maybe in a different way, in their own interpretations. Mm. And we have seen some people in our circle of people who are getting really confused. Mm. And so what would you advise, you know, I mean, people say read this person's book, read that person's book, don't listen to this monk's talks. You see, it's getting really a little bit out of hand. What would you advise?
They say also many books, there are hundreds of books out there about meditation, and they say most are written by people who don't meditate. Very few are from really meditators. As I was asked recently about which books would you recommend, what would you recommend to read? And I said, read anything, but have an open mind. Be very critical, open mind. But if I would say, read this books and don't look at the others, then that would be already, I would censor you already. So you can read anything you like, you think this might be good for me, read it, but have an open mind. Be very critical, also compare it all the time with your experience. And if there's any instruction there for your life, for your meditation, try it out. Try it, and if it works, take it, otherwise leave it. Also, I think it's every meditator should do that, to take different things from different tradition. There's one, maybe we're already late, so at the last short, very short Zen story, there was a Zen master, and he had a young monk, a young disciple. One day, the teacher thought he's ready, so he allowed him to give a Dhamma talk. So he was teaching a Dhamma talk, the teacher was sitting nearby. After the young disciple was over with the Dhamma talk, he gave a very good speech, a wonderful explanation of the Buddhist teaching. At the end, he looked at the teacher, what he thinks, and the teacher said, there's too much Buddhism in it. There's too much Buddhism in what you say. And meaning he was too much only on that tradition without using any other knowledge. So for me it was always, wherever it comes from, it doesn't matter. If it is helpful for my practice or for my spiritual development, I will use it. And so you can read any book, use anything, but use your critical thinking. Take whatever you like, whatever is useful for your practice, and just leave out the rest. And so that would be the best advice, I think. So there are read anything, but don't just accept it blindly. Use your reasoning and use whatever is useful for your practice. Okay, so with that we come to the end. It's already late. So you're all invited to join us on the other side for the community lunch. Also thanks for the technical team for doing the live streaming. They do a great job. So again, thanks everybody for coming. Have a very happy new year, a very successful new year. As I said, 2019, we will win. And so thanks everybody for coming, and have a very nice Sunday. Thank you.